Hello students, so welcome to the first lecture on survival analysis. Ramnathan sir has already given basic introduction to the course. He had shared the video lecture on Microsoft Teams. I hope all of you have joined the course created on Microsoft Teams. I have already informed Aditya to inform the rest of the students about it. So let us discuss the basics of survival analysis in more details in this course. So what do we mean by survival? So I think the word survival has been well known to us in the last year, that is 2020, a COVID year, where the question of survival was of immense importance. So we learnt so many things, how to have basic needs and all. So in statistical sense, now we will be studying survival probabilities and so the term survival analysis. So let us see what do we mean basically by survival analysis and what are the jargons associated with it. So it basically means the survival probability, study of survival probability or survival distribution of a system. Could be a lifespan of a living process before the occurrence of a particular event. Something like this. So what do we mean by that? So consider a situation where a clinical trial is going on and people have been reported to catch a particular infection. So one can say that once the study started, from that point onwards, the time at which people caught that infection, particular infection, that much time period would be the data, and one may be interested in knowing how much time was needed to catch that infection. So in that sense, that becomes the survival period of that particular person, and so or failure of that particular person, failure in the sense, failure in saving themselves from that particular disease, and so the data coming through these can be analyzed as a data, survival data. So usually the events of interest. So it can be in reliability, it can also be there in, as I mentioned, biostatistics, medical field. So let us one by one try to learn the intricacies of this. So the event of interest can be called as death, failure, breakdown, etc. So what do we mean by death? So death in literal sense, they don't mean death. In some cases, it can be actually death from a particular kind of heart transplant. Means heart was transplanted and it did not work well, and so ultimately the patient died. So even in literal sense, that would be death. But it can also be a failure to save that particular person from catching a specific disease. So again, that will be called as a death. So in that sense, these terms are used, death or failure or breakdown. So it can be in biological terms, or failure can be in mechanical terms. So I have listed a lot many examples of these, so where the distinction between these terms will be clear to you. So what survival analysis does is, once they have data associated with the failure times or time of occurrence of a particular event, they try to answer certain questions. So what are the questions? So the questions can be of this type. What is the proportion of a population which will survive past a certain time, or those who survive, at what rate they will die or fail? Then can multiple causes of death or failure be taken into account? How do particular circumstances or characteristics increase or decrease the probability of survival, and so on and so forth. So to answer all these questions, it is necessary first to define what do we mean by lifetime. So in the case of biological survival, death is unambiguous. In the sense, we know what we mean by the term death. But for mechanical reliability, means when it comes to items, non-living things, and when we talk about their lifetimes, failure may not be well defined. So it may depend on the context, how we or what we call as failure. So let us see in more details what do we mean by that. So the and what else is more important. So now the concept of the point event of failure should be defined. Sorry, this should not be then, this should be defined precisely. In the sense, what do we mean exactly by that particular event in which we are interested in? That should be clearly defined. So what do we mean by that? So if a light bulb, for example, is operating continuously, then the number of hours for which it burned should be used as the lifetime. So now when you put on a light bulb, obviously you won't be using it continuously. You would be switching it off, switching it on in between. So the number, when you say that the number of hours burned, it will be different as the now, because you are putting it off and on. So the shocks, the moment the electricity starts running in the light bulb, so the shocks of lighting and putting off, it will decrease the light bulb's life. And because there can be a voltage fluctuation as well, so considering these factors, the number of hours for which the light bulb is burned is not clear here. So in such cases, one should clearly define what do they mean by lifetime. So this example indicates that there may be more to defining a lifetime than just the amount of time spent under operation. So here by operation we mean that the usage of the light bulb. So what else then can be done? So to understand it better, let us consider a set of some examples so that what I am trying to convey you will be clearer to you. So consider the first example. A mechanical engineer conducts a fatigue test to determine the expected life of rods made of steel by subjecting N specimens to an axial load that causes a specified stress. So the number of cycles are recorded at the time of failure of every specimen. So what the mechanical engineer does is, he has certain items made up of steel. So he, suppose there are N specimens, say 100 specimens are there. Then and a particular axial load is applied to them. Now that axial load causes stress, and as a result, the rod on which this stress is applied may break down. So how many times, and so the entire specimen will break down. So how many times this happens, that if a particular stress is applied, then the rod or the specimen breaks down. So the number of times, so this is recorded at the time of failure of every specimen, means how many times it is done and how, what was the time of failure. So this is recorded for every specimen. So here see, the operation is nothing but the testing of that particular specimen, which is made up of steel. And the time or the event of interest is the failure of the specimen. And so the time here is nothing but the time of failure of that specimen. So this is what we are interested. So in this context, lifetime of the specimen is nothing but the time of failure, the time at which the specimen broke down, that will be the time of failure of the specimen. So now let us change the context. Kidney dialysis patients were given catheters using two types of surgical procedures. So now let me explain some background of this. The patients who have kidney failure, serious kidney failure, and who haven't got any kidney transplant, means whatever dysfunctional kidneys they have to work with that. So now to make their life simple or easier, a dialysis is conducted. Now every time when the patient has to go through dialysis, he has to, that's a painful procedure. The devices has to be attached to the patient. So every time the patient will be going through lot of pain. So to avoid that, certain devices are used as a permanent tool, or they are kept inside the body of the patient, so that every time then when the dialysis has to be done, then the patient did not have to go through the process of attaching those devices, outer devices, to his body separately. So instead that catheter can be used to start the procedure. So it will save time, and ultimately it can be less painful for the patient. So catheters are also used in cancer patients for carrying out radiational or similar treatments. So So now how can these catheters be placed inside the body of the patient? So there are two different types of surgical procedures. So what happens is, in both these types of surgical procedures, the patients tend to catch an exit site infection, because see, catheter is a foreign body. So when a foreign body is introduced to the human body, a certain kind of infection, because that's a foreign item inside our body, so our cells try to protect us from that particular object, and so as a result, some kind of infection can always happen. So the patients tend to catch infection here, a particular type of infection which is popularly known as exit site infection. So they tend to catch this infection, and it is here I have tried to explain that the infection caused due to the placement of a foreign item in the body. So the time to infection in months of kidney dialysis patients was recorded for both types of surgical procedures. So here, since the surgical procedures are to be compared, so once a patient got the catheter, then from that point onwards, at what time the patient caught exit site infection, that time in months was recorded for all the patients who went through both these surgical procedures. So this is again a survival data. Here, by lifetime we mean the time of infection, time of catching the infection of that kidney dialysis patient for both types of procedures. So let us consider now the next example. So a study was conducted on the effects of ploidy. Now what do we mean by ploidy? So it is the number of complete sets of chromosomes in a cell, on the prognosis of patients with cancers of the mouth. So in short, how many cells in the body of a patient having mouth cancer, so how many cells have lost some sets of chromosomes? So in short, what is ploidy? So when the cancer patient undergoes a treatment, there are several side effects of those treatments. You might have heard about them. People lose their hair, people lose their taste, they get angry, there are mood swings, and so on. So one effect which has been found in several mouth cancer patients is the effect on ploidy, that is the number of complete sets of chromosomes in a cell. So what will happen if this number reduces? The patient will lose his immunity, and as a result the patient eventually may die. So the death time of all these patients were recorded in the study. The purpose, what was the purpose of the study? So to check whether the treatment given to the patient has any effect on the ploidy, and if that is the case, then so to study this, the death times of the mouth cancer patients were recorded. So here clearly death or lifetime is clearly lifetime of that patient, but not from the beginning. This, by this they mean that the time from which the treatment was started, that time would be treated as an origin, and then from that time onwards, the remaining lifetime of that patient would be available with the people who conducted this study. So now let us consider the next example, recidivism. So what do we mean by recidivist or recidivism? So recidivist is a person who relapses into crime. So what do we mean? So there have been instances where people who have committed a particular type of crime have shown tendency to commit same type of crime again and again. So for example, those who are thieves, they tend to, once they are out of the prison, they again try to go back to their profession, and then they try to continue it. So this kind of tendency is called as relapse into the same kind of crime. So relapse into crime, in short. So a person who goes through this kind of relapse is called as recidivist. So in this study, newly released parolees are followed in time to see whether and when they get rearrested for another crime. Now what is the meaning of this? parallel. So what do we mean by parallelize or parallel? What is parallel? So you might have heard that person who has got some sentence, who is serving his sentence in a jail, if his behavior is well and good, then he is allowed to leave, he is allowed to go back to the society. But there is an officer associated with that person, that criminal. That officer is usually called as parole officer. His job is to keep an eye on the criminal, since the criminal has been allowed to go back to the society instead of serving his sentence in the prison. So such people who are allowed to go back to the society before completing their sentence are called as parolees. So because they haven't even finished the punishment they had received for their earlier crime, so they can be either very good persons or they can go back to their original nature and they may start committing the crime again. So the time from which the person or the criminal was released from jail to the time for which he was rearrested again, maybe it could be for the similar crime or could be for another type of crime, but he has a tendency to commit crimes, so that would be treated as a relapse. So this time duration is the point of interest. So here this time duration will be called as lifetime. So see, you who might have noticed, there are so many such a variety of applications when you pronounce the word survival, because survival can be of living things, living beings, or it can be of non-living items. So the moment you say non-living, you enter into engineering, reliability analysis and so on. The moment you say living beings, you are into biostatistics. So in that sense, survival analysis is a really broad area and it covers so many topics. So the approaches, various approaches developed under this course are actually very useful and very basic in nature and can be used to analyze so many type of data. So now this example spring testing, I am leaving it to you. I have already shared these notes with you, so I hope you will be able to understand it. So what is the common feature in all these examples? So in all of the above examples, you can notice that occurrences of certain events are of interest. In the first example, the event of interest is the failure of the specimen. In the second example, it is the catching of infection and so on. So every time, in every example which I have mentioned here, there is a event of interest, and time, occurrence time of that event of interest is nothing but the time in which we are interested in. So for example, that data is going to be available to us. So now what do we mean by the time? Here starting time or the origin is also equally important. So here the time need not be the time right from the beginning. It can be the starting time or origin is the time when the procedure to conduct the event is started. So when can we say that? So how do we define origin? So I had clearly mentioned it in the earlier example also. So origin will be the time when the procedure to conduct the event has started. So the time at which the mechanical engineer started conducting the test will be the origin in the first example, and the time at which the failure of the specimen, the time at which the mechanical engineer started conducting the test will be the origin, and the time at which failure of the specimen occurred will be the time of occurrence of the event in the first example. Similarly, now you can define origin and the time of occurrence of the event in all these examples. So what are the points, important points, which one should never miss while considering these two terms, time of occurrence of the event and the origin time origin. So the time origin should be precisely defined for each individual or item, correct? I think you will agree with this, because if it is not defined properly, then there will be a lot of confusion while collecting the data. Then the individuals or items under study should be as similar as possible at their time origin. Now why? What do we mean by this? So suppose there are cancer patients. We are studying their behavior, and we are suppose we are interested in a particular event associated with those cancer patients. Now if that particular event is associated with, say, heart of those functioning of the heart of those cancer patients, And if a particular person who enters the study has weaker heart compared to the other patients, then will it be fair to include that person in the study? Because that his heart being weaker, he may be susceptible to several issues associated with the heart, functioning of the heart. So as a result, he may show failure, or in the sense, catching of a particular problem associated with the functioning of the heart could be more probable for him than for the other patients. So when we consider a particular study conducted on a set of people, those people should be as much identical as possible. So when they should be identical, so they should be identical when the study is being started. So in that sense, this sentence is really important. Now, what do we mean by this? The time origin need not be and usually is not the same calendar time for each individual. Means what? Now, again, let us consider the cancer patients example. The cancer patients may be, suppose the study is like that the cancer patients are given certain treatment and then their response to that particular treatment is going to be recorded. So it's not necessary that all the cancer patients who are chosen for that particular study will start the treatment at the same time. Depending on their status of disease, the starting time of the treatment will be different for different patients. So as a result, the time origin won't be same as the calendar time for all these people. So I hope you have understood my point. And then most clinical trials have staggered entry so that patients enter the study over a period of time. So the survival time of a patient is measured from his or her own date of entry. So this is what I have tried to mention. So one more practical limitation faced by most of the executors of the experiment is the limitation of time. There is a time limitation in the sense, as the time proceeds, the cost of conducting the experiment increases. In fact, there are several costs which are directly associated with the time duration of the entire experiment or entire study. So, could be a labor, could be a human resource, could be cost of equipments needed for the experiment and so on. So, for example, suppose certain equipments need to be, hired. So, their hiring charges has to be given, their rent has to be given. And so, more the duration of the experiment, more will be the cost associated with those equipments. So, as a result, the cost of entire experiment will go on. So, in some cases, the experimenter is forced to stop the experiment in between, or he has to, even before all failures are observed, he has to stop. So, what do we say? So, such situations are referred to as censoring situations. So what do we mean by censoring? What is it? So let us study it in detail in the next lecture, because this lecture is already 23-24 minutes have already gone. So let us stop it here, and the discussion on censoring I'll include in the next class.